Welcome to our discussion of a perfect match. This does not involve match.com. It involves professional matching. And I think we've produced something creative and something that I think will be of interest to all of you. And I'm excited at the people that we're going to have here to discuss it. Let me first thank the Arconic Foundation for providing support for this effort. We're very grateful to them. This is our second study of workforce issues. We've done one in the past on the question of how to improve the worker training process for advanced manufacturing. And this one is about, stems from what was really a fairly initially naive idea, which is there's millions of people that are looking for a job, and there's about an equal number of jobs that are not filled in our country. So how do we put those together? Naive. What we learned, as with many things, is that it's more complicated than that. But I think what we've also learned is that it's something that we need to spend more time thinking about, and it's necessary. Our economy has gone through enormous changes in the last 30 years, particularly on with respect to manufacturing employment, which is where we're focused. There was a study that came out the other day that talked about the top 20 jobs that had disappeared between 1980 and 2017, so basically over the last 30 years. So looking at some of them, knitting mills, in terms of jobs, down 90%. Apparel and accessories, down 82%. Yarn, thread, and fabrics, down 81%. Footwear, down 80%. Coal mining, 76%. Cutlery, hand tools, 68%. Household appliances, 62%. Iron and steel, 58%. This does not mean we're not making this stuff. In some cases, it does. We're actually on a macro level making more stuff than ever, but we're doing it with a lot fewer workers, thanks to productivity improvements and technology improvements. And in some cases, footwear being a good example, we're simply not doing much of that at all anymore. The consequence of that is you've got a lot of people who have spent, in some cases, substantial parts of their lives doing these things who are no longer able to do so. And one of the things that I was particularly interested in is how can we speak to those people, and how can we find people who, how can we find a way, a better way to help people that are probably in the later stages of their career, who may not be as technologically facile as millennials, and help them develop, find ways to develop new careers. At the same time, we realize that's only a small and actually sort of shrinking part of the population, because it's the older end. We also have to pay a lot of attention to people that are entering the workforce and helping them do a better job of matching. And in the process, we discovered a lot of disconnects. How can employers provide more relevant information to job seekers, clearer information to job seekers, information that tells them what they want to know, that gives them a better idea of whether or not that's a job that they're qualified for and would be interested in having, so that they know that they can, that it would be worth their while to apply. And what can we say to those that are looking for work? What do they need to do to increase their chances of success? It's not all on the employer, obviously. The potential employee has to figure out how to use the information that's available to his or her advantage, and has to know, in fact, you know, what that information is and where it can be found. And we found problems in all these areas. We particularly looked at how to apply new technologies, including AI, to the job search and selection process, and you'll be hearing more about that in a few minutes. But as I said, we also looked specifically at how to meet the needs of people who might not be as technologically up to date as your average 24-year-old. Figured out how to try to figure out how to meet their needs as well. So in the process of doing all this, we learned again, as we learned in the last study, that sadly manufacturing has an image problem. People still think it's old, tired, and dirty. And what we heard in the last study over and over and over again is that, you know, manufacturing today is not your grandfather's factory. It's very different. But what we continue to encounter, not only in looking at worker training and the difficulties of getting people into training programs and making training programs successful, but we found here in getting people interested in these jobs is trying to overcome an outdated image of what work in manufacturing is all about. And the report takes a look at that, tries to figure out how to address it. I'm particularly happy that we've got a really great panel of experts, people who've devoted their careers to addressing precisely these issues. And I'm very glad that they were willing to join us today to talk about this. What we're going to do is that the author and lead researcher of our report is going to present it, and we've got some slides for you. And then when she's finished, I'll call the panel up and I don't know what that is, but anyway, we'll call the panel up and then we'll have a discussion, and we'll save time at the end for questions from you all. I hope that's not me. No. Let me now introduce our author and lead researcher. Kati Suominen is an adjunct fellow with the CSIS Europe program, but she's also become one of our favorite people, the Scholl Chair, and has helped us on a number of projects that we've had underway. She is founder and CEO of NextTrade Group, which is a Los Angeles-based data and analytics company that helps governments, multilateral development banks, and Fortune 500 companies enable world trade through technology. She's the author and editor of 10 books on trade, technology, and globalization, notably Revolutionizing World Trade, How Disruptive Technologies Open Opportunities for All, Peerless and Periled, The Paradox of America's Leadership in the World Economic Order, and many of others. She also serves as an adjunct professor at the UCLA Anderson School, where she teaches MBA courses on international business economics and the economics of global digital disruption. So she's got a very broad range of experience on a number of issues, including how to apply new technologies and digital technologies to emerging problems. So with that, I'm going to turn the podium over to Kati, and then, as I said, when she's done, I'll introduce the panel at that time.
Thanks, Bill, and thank you all for coming. And those of you who are joining from outside. Also, thank you for the members of our task force. We had a big group working with us, and this was a relatively new topic for us here at CSIS, certainly for me, and it was great to get everybody's input. So really, many thanks to everybody. This is a rather esoteric topic. You know, why do we think about hiring practices in manufacturing? Shouldn't we be thinking about the broader issues of skills development and training? But the further I went, the more I realized, looking at the literature and looking at the data out there, that this is actually a very relevant and big topic. And hopefully we can initiate conversation on this with some research and data that I'll show to you that we came up with during the work. So what struck me here, starting this work, with three things. One is that kind of there's a lot of generalizations about jobs in manufacturing. Manufacturing is oftentimes talked about as this monolithic, big one industry, when there are several sectors in the industry and there are hundreds of occupations, hundreds of categories. I know this is rather small, but this just shows you the different occupations in the industry, some of which are growing, oftentimes the more higher skilled categories in the coming years. Others of which are declining in the coming years, and great variety of jobs of low skill, medium skill, high skill employment in the sector. A lot of dynamism as well as categories change. Another thing that struck me going through this as this idea of a skills gap persists there's a lot of discussion around the idea that in America, we just don't have enough skilled people to perform certain jobs and or jobs in manufacturing. And at the same time, a lot of academic literature seems to tell us that, hey, we actually have an oversupply of skills. In fact, there's a recent study from OECD that suggests that in most American industries, including in manufacturing, there's an oversupply of skilled workers. If anything, we are mismatched to the point of this paper, that we are mismatched in the jobs that we do. A third of Americans are either over or underqualified for the jobs that they do, or the job applicants that are looking for work are not optimally sorted in the jobs. And that's kind of the challenge that we're seeking to tackle here. That rather than this idea of a skills gap, we actually have the skilled workers, they are just simply not matched optimally into jobs. Now, another thing that surprised me going into this discussion is that there's relatively little discussion around the hiring practices that might contribute to those frictions and mismatches in our labor market. There's quite a bit of literature on structural, cyclical issues, and many of you are experts on this, much more so than I am. But what struck me is that these kind of companies' hiring practices are not really widely explored. And when you look at what scholars in the field are talking about, there's great demand for analytics of this nature. Some of the leading academics in this field are actually calling for studies precisely of the kind that we're seeking to start here on recruitment, candidate selection, informational asymmetries between employers and employees as contributing to these mismatches. So this is an interesting field, and there seems to be great data challenges that have impeded this kind of analysis, but perhaps are now more possible than ever. So we're seeking to get at this through, you know, exploring the literature a little bit, looking at different studies that have been done, and looking also at certain surveys that are out there on different topics of hiring. Before I get there, let's look at kind of 101 on manufacturing. These are the various sectors, kind of broader sectors within the manufacturing industry. After the recession, employment has been growing in certain of the largest manufacturing categories, such as transportation equipment, food manufacturing, fabricated metal products. And in others, employment has been continuing to decline, apparel, textiles, paper products, and so forth. When we're looking at the hiring dynamics, we see that after kind of 2011, there's quite a bit of job openings in manufacturing, both durable, non-durable, similar patterns. And also hiring has been going up bit by bit. And we also see that quits have increased. Perhaps people are retiring, but also people are leaving to look for other jobs, which then creates new openings. And you know, we have more and more churn in the industry. This is nothing different from the broader economy. In fact, when we look at the ratio of hires to vacancies in across different sectors, including non-durable and durable manufacturing, we see that vacancies have outpaced hirings across these different and continue doing so across different industries. And there are actually many more vacancies in, say, health or government, finance, and insurance than in manufacturing as well. So it's a very dynamic time, a lot of people moving around, shifting jobs, leaving manufacturing, or perhaps staying in the industry but leaving their jobs, a lot of churn in the process, and of course these long-term dynamics as well, as we saw in the earlier slides. Now, the question is, well, how difficult is it then for companies to hire? We hear about this skills gap, and gosh, it's so difficult to find labor out there and skilled labor to work in our plants, and many companies in many industries have articulated this view. Well, how difficult is it in manufacturing? I actually expected that it would be much more difficult than what the data seem to indicate of the challenges and the time it takes to hire. The time it takes to hire tends to be the proxy kind of for hiring difficulties that is widely used in the literature. And there's a nice study by two scholars, Weaver and Osterman, that we refer to a lot in the paper. It's a random sample of 900 manufacturing firms, nice survey. And they found that the median firm takes about 20 days to find and hire a worker. The average firm, about 30 days, you know, 6 weeks or so. We ran a little survey, indicative survey, just a random sample, 200 manufacturing firms. And what we found is that in the majority of cases, companies tended to find or hire a person within 5 weeks or so, in some cases 7 weeks. But we did not see these astronomically difficult or long vacancies that one might perceive reading some of the literature about skills shortages. There's a further indicator called DHI hiring indicators that I think has been discontinued in the past year, but it also shows that manufacturing is not that different from other industries. Vacancies tend to last about 30 days in manufacturing, just like in many other industries, and are kind of corroborated by survey data as well. So, you know, another thought that one wants to leave out there is that long vacancy, even if these numbers were worse, it wouldn't necessarily tell us that manufacturers are struggling to hire and it's difficult to find workers. There's a number of reasons why a vacancy may be open for a long time. One of them being the opposite problem, that there may be a curse of the riches where you have so many applicants that it takes you some time to just go through it. So I think we want to be also careful with this indicator when we look at the length of vacancies and extrapolate from that and think that that only suggests a great struggle to hire. But this also doesn't necessarily mean that manufacturers are wrong about the challenges to find talent. In our working group, there were a number of manufacturers and they kept telling us about examples in different parts of the country, how they have had challenges to find the 5 to 10 people on a new plant in a specific occupational category. And I was puzzled by that for a while because I thought, well, why am I not seeing this in the data if, you know, people who are from leading manufacturing companies keep telling us about this? And I thought there are ways to reconcile the two views. That, you know, one view is that there's this skills gap and we just can't find workers. And another view is borne by this data that it doesn't seem to be that very difficult to find a person to work for you. And one thought is, of course, that the shortages of workers can be very localized, that there is a certain job open in a certain place in America. And even if scholars and data showed that, yes, there are workers all around the country who could do this kind of a job, they just don't necessarily show up or even see the job posting in that one place. So that's, you know, a manufacturer may, in that case, perceive a skills shortage. And they may say, well, we have a skills gap problem, whereas a scholar looking at data across the country does not see that. And, you know, this can be very much reconciled. And with further data work, you might actually get at this issue. The shortages can also be very specific subsectorals, you know, in a specific occupational category, and we just don't see them in the bigger data. And furthermore, you know, the hires may be subpar. So the manufacturer may hire somebody, but they feel like the person is not really up to the task, and they may perceive another way of them for them to perceive a skills gap, and we don't necessarily see that in the data. What we see is a higher in the data. Now, of course, you know, we might also want to say or think about this problem as, well, you know, 30 days. It takes 30 days on average to get a person on a job. Couldn't we accelerate that? And furthermore, if we buy those arguments that in the future manufacturing jobs will be, you know, different kind and manufacturers may spend more time in particularly finding the higher skilled workers, that, you know, wouldn't we want to accelerate this? So we, in our little survey, again, this is indicative, 200 firms, so, you know, take it for what it's worth, but we looked at different skill categories of workers in manufacturing and asked manufacturers, how difficult is it for you to find workers in these different buckets? And it seemed that the toughest for firms of all sizes were employees in the higher skilled categories, whether it's kind of IT types of people, engineers, MBA types, and then for the lower skilled, it's easier, it seems, to find lower skilled people. In our task force, it seemed that manufacturers were also concerned about the middle skilled kind of machinist type of workers. And there is some evidence that from other studies that corroborates this. Weaver and Osterman found that it's the jobs that are harder to fill are in the technical more firm-specific jobs, that manufacturers may be actually looking for a person who is really specific to a specific job in it for a specific company, and that's why we observe longer vacancies in some of those very specialized high-skilled categories. Deloitte has this paper out there with a, you know, with the National Association of Manufacturers, a non-random sample of 400 executives, and they found that in certain categories, such as in engineers and scientists, it takes a long time to find a hire. The methodologies for these studies are somewhat different, so again, you know, one needs to take these with a grain of salt, but there is some evidence that in the higher skilled categories, it's tougher to find workers. So then how do we find, how do we overcome some of these challenges, and how do we do this cheaper? There's actually quite a bit of literature also on the cost that it takes for companies to hire $4,000 on average for the higher skilled categories, or C-level folks even more so. So perhaps we can also alleviate some of the HR cost by doing this work. So what I've kind of simplified the literature that does exist on the contributors to the mismatch of workers to jobs. I'll put it in three buckets. One bucket is kind of structural and cyclical issues in the economy. You know, do we have flexible enough labor regulations so that workers can leave for new jobs easily? Employers can get rid of workers that are underperforming, and so on. And it seems that the United States does quite well on these broader issues compared to other OECD nations. Another category of explanations is kind of firm-specific explanations, that perhaps there are some struggles that are unique to small firms versus larger firms. Perhaps there are struggles, more struggle experienced by rural firms to draw talent than by urban firms. An interesting thing that, for instance, in the Weaver and Osterman study was that it doesn't seem that firms in remote areas experience great difficulty finding workers. It's rather firms in industry clusters where there's a lot of peer firms in the same industry competing for the same talent. So yes, there's a lot of workers in those industry clusters and a lot of talent around, but there's also more competition for the talent. And that's what they found, that it's actually easier perhaps for the remote companies to find talent. What we want to focus on here is the firm's hiring and retention practices, kind of informational asymmetries and other dynamics, behavioral dynamics, biases, and things like that, that seep in and may cause frictions and limit the optimal sorting of workers in the jobs. So I have a couple of observations for you. A very simple way to think about this, and all of us have at some point probably gone through this kind of employment funnel. And those of us who are, you know, hiring people, we employ a funnel of this kind with different variations of the theme. But you can also think of this as, you know, multi-layered kind of system where there's a lot of things that can go wrong as a candidate either seeks to enter or is going through the funnel. So, you know, there are a number of hypotheses in the literature, in surveys, in more kind of casual writing out there on what can go wrong here. One is obvious, that candidates just simply don't necessarily see the posting. Most people are working today in America, you know, they're not actively looking for jobs, and they may not just find or see the posting for a job. They may see the posting, but they may not apply for a number of reasons. They don't like the brand of the company, they don't see the salary and benefit data that they really want to see. They suspect that there's already an internal pick for the position, and why bother applying, that this company is just doing this, you know, posting for an company policy reasons. The candidate may opt to network instead of even going to the funnel, very common reason why a candidate may not even enter. You know, you just want to get at the executive and talk to him or her directly rather than why bother going through this when you can go more directly. And the candidate may start to apply but never finish the application because the job is just so complex and the qualifications listed are so demanding. And what we found is in our little survey is that indeed it seems that this top part of the funnel is perceived by manufacturers as being the problem. We will never know perfectly whether it's for real or not, because they don't necessarily ever see the candidates that don't apply ever for the position. But it seemed that in firms of all sizes, again, some of these initial steps of getting candidates to apply, getting enough candidates so that you have a pool to draw on to apply, seem to be big problems. And for larger firms, and again, we have a small sample to draw on, but for larger firms, it seems that to get kind of quality materials from candidates in is a challenge, and getting also, you know, helping recruiters understand what the company is looking for is another challenge. And there's quite a bit of random surveys out there on the internet, and we went through a number of studies, you know, surveys done by LinkedIn and other firms on these different issues in these different areas. And what one finds is that, now, of course, applicants, if you're looking for work, you want to spread your risk and you want to look at a number of jobs. If you're already working and you want to perhaps move to a different job, you're busy working. So, you know, you want a quick application, send it in very quickly. And supposedly people who make 100,000 or more are kind of higher income brackets, want to spend as little time as possible, less than 15 minutes. And once they start that application, if it lasts 45 minutes, they'll drop out at some point. Supposedly a big problem. A big problem also that the job posting oftentimes has a number of screening questions, and supposedly some surveys indicate that once you get past you know, 3-4 dozen questions, a candidate again drops out and gives up, if you will. And then postings that do not list pay or benefits seem to be a really a turnoff for a lot of candidates. In our casual reading of postings in manufacturing, about 50% of the firms did not say what they would be paying for the position or what kinds of benefits the candidate would be getting. So, you know, perhaps there's something about the way postings are written and you know, the demands that are out there that make candidates self-censor, if you will. And then, you know, those of you who are more academic, you may have seen recent papers on the question of, well, is it, is there a skills gap, or is it just that manufacturers and companies in general are so demanding that there's a skill inflation and more qualifications expected? And that seemed to happen in job postings and jobs in general in America after the recession, when there was a lot of free labor floating around. Companies tightened their qualification criteria, their educational criteria and demands in job postings. And that has then, according to some scholars, contributed to this sense that there's a skills gap, that people just can't be these purple squirrels that companies are looking for. But it actually has a lot to do with how companies are framing the job position and the qualifications that are required, that has contributed to the idea of skills gap. Now back to our funnel. So to the bottom part, you know, we found some evidence that some companies feel that the recruiters can be very rigid and they screen out the talent inadvertently in the process. Background checks can be too tight in certain companies, and firms don't also know what they need. I know, you know, David is probably going to be talking about this, that we need much better measurement in companies of what kinds of workers, where do the outperforming workers come from, and why do they outperform? There are some companies like Tata Industries in India that have done a brilliant job in measuring workers and figuring out which schools did they come from, the best ones, and informing their hiring practices by looking at the performance of workers in the jobs today. But apparently many firms just don't do this yet, and I'm a big believer myself in something like this. And a big challenge seems to be that there's less and less internal training in companies, which leads to people saying, well, you know, I'm not getting trained, I'm not getting promoted here, I'm out of here, companies have to hire, and that creates a vicious cycle when the company then looks at the new hire and says, well, why should I train this person when they are bound to leave for the next job very soon? And it seems that there is empirical evidence around this. In one paper, manufacturers seem to be providing training. In the 1990s, maybe 70-80% of manufacturers were providing training in the companies. Now it's probably 50%. When you look at broader patterns in the economy, the numbers are even worse, if you will, if you believe in internal training in companies. And in our little survey, we asked the question, well, would you rather spend the money on retraining a well-performing worker in your company versus finding an excellent candidate from the labor market for the same position? And most people said that, yes, we would like to groom internal talent. Others said, well, maybe I would like to know a little bit what other talent exists out there. And research actually indicates that that's a smart strategy as well. It's, oftentimes companies get very myopic and narrowly focused on one candidate and perhaps miss better ones out there as well. But nonetheless, it seems that there's support for this idea that, we need to groom talent internally, and there's a lot of good people under our noses, who are just to look and invest in them. Now, the silver bullet question for me, and this was one of the questions in our first roundtable, was, well, it's a market like any other. Shouldn't we just pay better for the talent and attract talent that way? It seems from the NAM Deloitte survey that manufacturers have actually been doing this. Most manufacturers have been increasing salaries and benefits to attract better people. This may be the case across industries, of course, so we don't know how different manufacturers are from other companies, but it seems that manufacturing salaries in most manufacturing sectors and the industry itself trails other industries such as finance and insurance management industries, professional services industries, and so on. So if you're in a management occupation or in an installation occupation or production occupation, and you look at the world and you look at different sectors and you look at salaries in those sectors, you will find that in aerospace, yes, aerospace in sector within manufacturing pays well, but other sectors within manufacturing do not seem to pay as well as many other industries, such as professional services or finance and insurance. So if you are in these occupational categories, you may see attractive opportunities in other industries, pay-wise. And yeah, if there was a skills gap in manufacturing, we might expect that salaries would rise in manufacturing occupations and manufacturing industry, and we don't necessarily observe that in the data, at least so far. So, recommendations. We actually asked the manufacturers in our online survey of, well, what would you recommend your peers do? If they are facing these hiring challenges, what would be the key three things that you would propose to them? And most manufacturers just said, well, I would just tell them to advertise more online and on the internet, and it's kind of an easy thing, I guess, to answer and suggest. There were other recommendations, do much more on social media, something that it seems that Fortune 500s and manufacturers in general are not optimizing it, are not doing sufficiently. Some favor advertising jobs by the military as well. And of course, the internal hires and promotions and referrals seem to be another important strategy that people highlight. And further strategies that we suggest in the paper is, of course, migrate to the sites and screens where people are looking for work, using some more modern techniques that David will be sharing with us on how to screen applicants that are coming in, forcing self-selection of candidates into jobs. There are some companies like Google and Marriott that have created very nice programs for candidates to look at, or applications to look at, what would a day in the life in a company look like? Like, would I actually like this job? To make it more real, and then have kind of tests for applicants, for them to self-test themselves or self-assess, would they like this job, would they perform well? And perhaps by virtue of that, you can limit and narrow the funnel and get at the more relevant candidates who are well-positioned and interested in the job. Of course, networking, all of these things. If candidates are networking, not going through the funnel, then manufacturers have to network as well. List pay and benefits, pay better, pretty straightforward ideas. And then in the vetting process, in the kind of middle part of the funnel, again, the measurement of who performs well, where do they come from, can we kind of find a pattern in the data, a systematic way to get at outperformers out there to accelerate the process of hiring, and maybe, you know, use AI as well in the process, and then retrain to retain talent. Seems to be in great demand, and something that we're not doing as well as we used to. Some public policy recommendations. Well, this was this is a tough one for public policy. We see a lot of platforms, federal, state sponsored platforms that seek to match workers to a job. But I at least have not seen a lot of impact analyses of do these work, and should government even be in this business of having job postings? I guess, you know, the more the merrier, but we just don't understand too well how these platforms work. And if any one of you knows, we'll welcome that, of course. On the job training programs, there's some evidence seem to work nicely, but supposedly companies don't know how to use them or how to apply for them, or even what kinds of programs are available at state or federal levels. So there's some capacity building that seems to be needed. And also new codes as employment categories diversify and become different with industry, with technology, we need new codes for companies to use so that they can apply for money for training companies, for employees in those categories, using those codes. And of course, encouraging geographic mobility, something that is much beyond this particular paper. And finally, we need more granular data, something that we can discuss during our panel on just these issues. I don't think we know a whole lot. I'm a person who's worked a lot on trade data and international trade. We're blessed with a great deal of very granular data going back years and so on. But in this area, I was surprised by the data challenges and gaps, and hopefully these kinds of survey-based approaches will give us a finer sense of what's going on out there and how to alleviate the frictions that manufacturers report as they are looking for workers. So thank you.
Particular chair?
Just, I'll sit at the end, so other than that, no. Well, thank you for the presentation, Katie. That was very thorough, although I have to say there's a lot of stuff, there's a lot more in here than what she was able to cover, but we didn't want an 85-minute presentation and 5 minutes for questions. We wanted to have some discussion, pardon me, on the part of experts. So there's more I think we can tease out of the report, and I hope that some of the conversation that we're about to have will do that. Let me introduce the panel for you and then start the conversations, not in the order in which they're sitting, but David Barnes, who's in the middle, is the Vice President for Global Workforce Policy at IBM. He leads their global agenda in workforce public policy and oversees IBM's advocacy on a range of issues, including the future of work, labor and employment rules, skills, diversity, global workforce deployment, and corporate responsibility. In other words, pretty much everything that we're talking about. He's also in the past held executive roles for IBM, not only in the United States, but in China, Japan, Italy, and Australia. To David's left is Jerry Fiala, who is an independent consultant and former Deputy Assistant Secretary of Employment and Training at the Department of Labor. In that position, she was responsible for leading the department's implementation of the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act, along with the initial design and implementation of the Trade Adjustment Assistance Community College and Career Training Grant Program, which has the longest acronym I've ever seen, and which was a $2 billion investment, though, to increase the capacity of community colleges to address today's workforce challenges and employer skill needs. Prior to that, she was staff director for the Senate Help Subcommittee on Employment and Workplace Safety, which was chaired by Senator Patty Murray. To David's right is Marianne Pacelli, who has been and is about to be something else, but has been the program manager workforce development at NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology, the Hollings Manufacturing Extension Program, for the past 4 years. Her work includes advocating for manufacturing workforce priorities with related federal agencies and providing technical support to the network of MEP centers across the country. This is a nationwide program for workforce-related activities. Previously, she was Assistant Director of Workforce Training Development at Magnet, which is an Ohio MEP affiliate. So she's got basically state experience as well as federal experience, which is, in this particular area, extremely important. Finally, next to me is Neil Ridley, who is director of the State Initiative Program at Georgetown University Center on Education and the Workforce. He's been doing that since 2014. That center is an independent, nonprofit research and policy institute that studies the link between education, career qualifications, and workforce demands. He's a co-author of a number of reports on good jobs in the U.S. economy, which describe trends in job opportunities that are available to workers at all education levels. Before coming to the center, he was a senior policy analyst with the post-secondary education and workforce team at CLASP, where his focus was unemployment, workforce development, and post-secondary education and training policy. So we've got a group of people who really know what this is about, which I'm delighted to have that. And it's hard to know where to begin because Kati presented so many different issues. Let me begin with technology, because that was one of the things she alluded to on several occasions. And maybe start with David, if you're willing, and may say, and then others chime in as you wish. What role do you see technology and social media playing in the future of hiring and its ability to better match workers' jobs? And also talk about big data analytics and AI and the role it will play eventually in the same process.
Thanks, Bill. I guess I should declare an interest in that IBM not only uses these technologies in our own hiring and recruitment programs, but of course we build them and we sell them to clients. We also provide clients with consulting in this space, and for some clients run their entire recruitment operations, you know, from finding applicants to onboarding. So we have a deep interest in this space, not only for our own purposes, but for our commercial interests as well. But bottom line is we use AI and machine learning and things like that to hire more effectively and make more objective hiring-based decisions. That's the bottom line. We help candidates decide if IBM's a good fit for them and their skill profile. We use AI to rank people. We use it to support assessments of candidates more objectively. We use it to transparently match candidates to other jobs in IBM that they may not have thought of. We use skills inference to look at their resume and figure out, well, you know, that kind of profile has been successful in the past at a different kind of job than the one you're actually applying for. Are you interested in this? And it turns out that about 40% of the people who are offered those alternatives go ahead and apply for them. So we're using the technology right through the recruitment process. As Kati said, it's not the only solution to this skilling problem. We use it to accelerate the process. It's much faster than traditional hiring processes. But the other thing employers have to do, and I'll put reskilling of their existing workforce aside for 1 minute, because that's an entirely big topic on its own. Yeah. But the other thing that employers really need to do is to recalibrate what they're hiring for. In other words, look at their job profiles and say, is this the right set of qualifications that's really necessary for this job? Cuddy mentioned this question of overspecking, and we've gone through that process. And we used to have a four-year minimum degree hiring standard here in the US. We've put that aside now. And now after 2 years, 15% of our hires do not have a college degree. And so addressing new labor pools, which recalibrating your job requirements allows you to do, opens up whole new categories of workers. It allows you more diversity. It allows you new regional sourcing opportunities. And frankly, it provides opportunity for people to enter the technology sector who may not have had them before. So Bill, we see technology as providing a lot of benefits both to employers and to candidates. It allows us to, tighten the aperture on the kind of employee who's going to be successful in the job.
Neil, do you want to add something?
Yes, I mean, as David says, technology has really arrived. We're not waiting for it. It's already arrived as far as employers are concerned, and as far as the job market is concerned, there have been major advances in the past 20 years or so in the ability to collect job postings that employers use to find candidates, parse the information in those profiles or in those ads, and then analyze it and then disseminate it to improve the functioning of the job market. And of course, artificial intelligence is used in a number of ways. It's used to parse and process some of the text, for example, the words and phrases in job ads, and turn it into meaningful information. It's also used for matching on whether public sites or private sites as well. So we've come a long way in the use of technology, and I think it's had a couple of effects. For one, it's widened the net for on the employer side and on the individual job seeker side. So employers immediately have access to a much broader array of candidates, in some cases a flood of candidates, right? And individual job seekers have a much wider array of companies and options across, not just in their town, but across the region or across the country. I would say that the increasing use of technology is held back to some extent by a couple of limitations, and in particular, the quality of some of the underlying data that is fed into the job descriptions or job ads and the structure of those job ads. So when you look at job ads beyond a single employer, it's often a jumble. It's job ads are across, just they vary very much across the board. So half of them do not have any kind of educational description or educational expectation, for example, or minimal skills description. And so there are some initiatives underway to try to add structure to the data, the job postings, the job ads that really create the fabric for the job matching process. And so, for example, the Chamber Foundation has a really interesting project to try to develop, add more structure, come up with data standards for job ads that are used by multiple employers, and actually allow employers to benchmark their job descriptions and use best practices and connect them to ways to look at credentials across industries as well. And then also Credential Engine is another initiative that is trying to add structure, especially in the credentialing, the education credentialing market as well.
Let me pursue that last thing for just a second, and others chime in as you wish. One of the things that came up in the research was a feeling, and you alluded to this, that the announcements that employers put out about jobs available don't always provide the information that job seekers are looking for. Salary information is often missing or very late in the announcement, and salary benefits and things like that. Things that the job seeker wants to know first as a way to sort of winnow through these things. And I suppose the employer's answer might be, we don't do that because we want to keep the top of the funnel as wide as we possibly can, and get lots of applicants in, then we'll decide, rather than have people self-select, that this isn't the right thing for them. Which is the right way to do that? Is it better to narrow the funnel at the top, or to keep it wide and leave prospective employers more in the dark? Marianne?
Manufacturing Extension Partnership program that I'm part of is a national program of extension centers across the country that works specifically with small and mid-sized manufacturing companies. So we're working with those companies that have less than 500 employees. Many of them are privately owned, and it's over 85% of the manufacturing establishments in the country. Those companies are wary of, AI and technology, and to your point, they don't do a good job of defining the skills and competencies that are needed. They are working off job descriptions that are 25 years old. They're looking for, as Cady said, the purple squirrel, because they know they don't, or they don't know how to invest in the training of somebody who doesn't have all the skills that they're looking for. So they get very leery of posting things like wage information, because a smaller manufacturer is struggling to compete with IBM, Lockheed Martin, whose chances are could be their customer in the town that they're in. So it's a struggle. They want to bring as many people in as possible and hope that they can negotiate when they find the right person. And that's a reason why your smaller companies are probably more hesitant than larger companies to post their jobs.
Now, is this something your program works with them on, to get them over this hump?
Yeah, many of our centers are starting to work with companies on, first, better defining the job, better defining the potential of what they can expect to hire and what they need to think about training, and how to become a more employer of choice in that small manufacturing market. And if they're hiring people up through middle skill and even entry-level engineering jobs and frontline supervisors, majority of the people who are going to come to apply for them are people who live in that area. They're not going to be looking across the country to move somebody into Milwaukee or a suburb of Pittsburgh or somewhere in Iowa or Idaho. Those companies are really going to be hiring from within, so they need to build their own reputation in their community so that somebody wants to come knock on their door. And we spend some time trying to help those companies get better at that.
Jerry, you want to add something or not?
I guess a couple of things. I think that the point that's made about the locality is really important, particularly for small and medium-sized companies, and the ability to, transportation becomes an issue in the decision-making process of people applying. But I think also you have to consider, I go back to something David said, you have to identify and think through what are these skills. What do I want this person to be able to do? What are the duties, in defining it clearly in the advertisements for jobs? And in some cases, words matter so much, particularly if it is you have the robo words, if you will, and even not where it's a smaller company and they're looking at resumes. For example, somebody might be welding jewelry together, but actually could be that skill could be applied over here to a welder or a machinist. But jewelry repair as a hobby, how do you get from here to there? So there's a lot of work, I think, that needs to be done to help both, if you will, career counselors within public centers where people could apply for jobs or labor exchanges, as well as small business people who are trying to figure out how to articulate what they need. And I think that's something that I'm reaching over but into the public sector, where there are public labor exchanges, state job banks in many cases that partner with people like, or companies like Monster.com, to help this process along.
Just for some background, we've got Jerry, who used to be in government, you're in, still in the government, but both in the federal government. What, say a few, a bit more about what the role of the federal government might be, and what pieces of this process, but then also whether there's a role for state and local government as well.
Oh, there's a huge role, frankly, at the state level and the local level. I mean, the federal government may provide a framework and guidance, but the and funds that go down. But when you're talking about things that the state, you're talking about, for example, the development of state job banks. And those, every state has one that's accessible to anyone who's looking for work, but also accessible to any employer who wants to put up a job order or job application. And I think, Katie, you mentioned the Ohio example, but you know, the challenge is that they're in every state. There's a lot of federal money that goes down. States sometimes put in their own, but they're all named differently. So there becomes a challenge for a company that has facilities in different states. But you have, they are all Career One Stop or America Job Bank related. But you have, for in California, you have a labor exchange. It's called the California Job Openings Browsing System, or Cal Jobs. In Pennsylvania, it's the Career Link. In Illinois, it's the Job Link. In Washington State, it's the workforce system. The only one that's very clearly says what it is the New York system, which says it's the New York Job Bank. Okay. So there is a lot of money that's being put into supporting that. But I will say that, you know, these states are also challenged because it is an online bank. It is not, there's the mobile technology, the social media is not necessarily part of those state banks, and that's a challenge.
Yeah, there's, from the federal system, there's, as Jerry said, most we can do is make recommendations and figure out how, as we move money out, most of it comes out of Department of Labor ETA through the Workforce Innovation Opportunity Act, goes into the states, and on the upside, the states are given flexibility to meet the needs of their region, of their state, but because of that, you end up with differences. And on state lines where people cross over, it's a challenge. But the federal system is re-looking at it again. There's been another executive order out of the Trump administration about less than a year ago that formed the American Workforce Policy Advisory Board, which is made up of people across the nation representing companies of all industries. It wasn't just focused on manufacturing. And people representing different industry sectors, like the National Association of Manufacturers is on this board. And they recently just came up with a new set of recommendations that is going back to the White House to see how, between labor and commerce is leading the advisory board, what are the things that can be done. And some of what we're talking about here is coming out of those recommendations also. Data transparency and the sameness of data across the country. As Jerry was saying, all these states have different job boards. They all look a little different. They all behave a little different. Some, you know, from the outside looking in, some might look better than others. But that data doesn't exchange even from state to state all the time. So if you are a company who has multiple locations, you have to learn five different systems maybe. If you're an individual who lives on a border of two or three different states, you have to apply differently or look into different systems to find things. So how do we kind of create the interstate commerce of labor exchanges? We need to modernize recruitment. That's one of the recommendations they realized. And they realized that companies need help in getting better at defining jobs, which is what we've talked about, so they can utilize AI and other technology as they're looking for people and be able to better understand in this skills mismatch piece, which does exist. If I have somebody, can I define what skills they have and know enough to say, here's the training I need, here's the training gap, and I'm willing to take that risk and make that investment, because I know exactly what I need to train that person. Smaller companies are not at that level yet because they don't have big HR departments and training departments like an IBM. They just don't. Their HR person might be, you know, part-time CFO and part-time HR. They just hire based on what they did in the past. We need help. Our MEPs are trying to help. We need to educate our career centers, and as Jerry said, because so much of our one-stops have gone online, the people side of it, of helping an individual better understand their skills and how can they present themselves differently in an interview, and how can they help companies be better at defining their job so the career center can help them find somebody. It's a challenge.
So this is absolutely a fun question. Does IBM have much interaction with state and local, federal and local governments, or are you big enough and well enough not to have to deal with those kinds of students that you're talking about?
Well, mostly big enough, Bill. but look, the state and local government services are really important when we're looking at the supply side of our hiring equation. And we want to work with them to improve the profile of the person that's coming to IBM in that locality or region or state. And we get encouragement for them to work on curricula with community colleges, for example, to bring them up to date so we can get intakes of people into our new apprenticeship schemes. We've adopted 20-odd new apprenticeship profiles for the technology sector, the first of a kind, as another means of getting at this kind of skills availability problem. So yes, the states and the local government and their investment agencies as well as their employment organizations have got an important role to play, but for the smaller companies, there's a lot to be careful about with AI, quite frankly, because it's not a cookie cutter solution.
Exactly.
It very much has to be tailored to the individual employer and their culture and their organization structure and their requirements. And frankly, there are vendors out there selling software solutions which are essentially a black box. They're not transparent and they're not explainable. And from IBM's perspective, any AI which has anything to do with people needs to be transparent and needs to be explainable. You need to know what data went into training it, who did it, who did that training, what assumptions were made about it. That has to be, and at the end, we believe if a decision is going to be made about a person, the final arbiter should be another person. So our AI systems in the recruitment space provide insights, options, and recommendations that to a person. They're not designed to automatically, consign someone to the outbox or, move them forward automatically, if you will.
How we can increase awareness among workers about certain skills and what jobs out there that seem important.
Yes, I mean, in addition to the job banks that Jerry and Marianne talked about, there's also been a proliferation, a spread of other online tools and resources that are available to workers. And so at the federal level, the federal government level, the U.S. Department of Labor has done and really started doing pioneering work going back to 2000 or the late 1990s. There are a number of tools available that, under the category of the Career One-Stop. And the Career One-Stop really includes a range of tools aimed at workers. For example, military personnel that are leaving, transitioning into hopefully civilian jobs, into the civilian workforce, and for workers in all many different circumstances. The Career One-Stop also includes a number of skill assessments that individuals can use to determine what they've been using on their most recent job or their current job and how that can position them for the next job or a better job or whatever it might be. And then also at the state level, again, to follow our flow of thought here from federal tools to state tools, a lot of states have invested, not quite as many in job as there are in job banks, but a number of states have invested in these worker outward-facing tools. For example, Minnesota has a particularly interesting tool called JobStat, which allows individuals to determine what their transferable skills are and you know, how they could be positioned for related jobs. And so I think we've seen a lot, we've seen a variety of tools come into the market on the, and also there, I should say, there are a number of private proprietary tools as well that are available. Skill assessments, online skill assessments that individuals can use. So we've seen a lot of tools come onto the market. I think the area where we're still trying to make progress in this, and we've all alluded to this, is in the skills space. How can we measure skills better, especially the skills that are needed for the latest technologies and the digital skills that are becoming much more important? It's a lot easier to measure some of the basic skills than some of these the latest and greatest or the you know the most current, the hot skills, so to speak. And so I think, and then also moving and trying to ensure that some of these tools use not just self-reported skills assessments, but more validated skills assessments mm-hmm. as well.
Bill, could I just, I just wanted to reinforce one thing that Neil said. Most of the tools and the research are based on actually going out and looking at what workers perform, what they're doing, the equipment that they use, and talking and looking at both workers and their interactions with supervisors. All of that database is used to build these tools, and it's affectionately called something ONET, which is the Occupational Skills Network something. I can't remember the name. But the reason why I wanted to bring that up is the tool that Neil mentioned where military personnel can actually, there's a tool that will allow them to go in and translate what's in their military occupational specialties to civilian jobs and the skills there. But what Neil didn't mention, and I do want to say, is there's another tool where employers can go and look at their civilian job requirements and translate that into the military occupational specialties of veterans coming out. So, and these tools are available through the Career One Stop, but also, you know, the Defense Department, all of the military branches. But I think that is important in terms of sort of accelerating the time from transition into a new job or knowing precisely what skill you may lack or credential you may need to get before you can get that new job.
But the first piece, getting back to the question, is you know, how do we get more skilled people going after skills for manufacturing? It's a challenge. Mm-hmm. Manufacturing did it to themselves, and they realized that over the years, the publicity about manufacturing has not been all that stellar. Lots of layoffs in a lot of big companies over the early years. People think that it's not a stable work, it's not a stable job. And the pictures of old-time manufacturing are not conducive to today's young people and even today's middle-aged people thinking about changing careers and walking into a manufacturing plant. So first, today is Manufacturing Day. it's a national campaign started about 6 years ago with the Association of Manufacturers, and the MEP system supports
Perfect
it.
Timing.
We try and encourage companies, especially our small mid-sized companies, to do something. Open their doors, pay a couple hundred dollars for a bus to get some students to come in, show them what are the exciting jobs in your manufacturing plant. So manufacturers are realizing they have to step up their game to get the right people to think about going into their jobs because they're there, but they're not knocking at their door. They're thinking about getting an IT certificate, which isn't a bad thing, and many manufacturers need them too. But they're not always initially thinking of maybe there's a career in manufacturing. I could go to college, get a 2-3, be a machinist, go into welding, go into maintenance. They're afraid to do it, the parents aren't, and the schools aren't even promoting it. So it's changing, the needle is moving, I can tell you that. we see that the needle changing, more students are considering career and technical school as an option to at least get started. Career and technical schools are changing their message to parents as they're recruiting those young high school students of saying this isn't an end game. We have dual enrollment. You can get community college credit as you finish your high school degree. You can get a job or you can go on to college. So starting to see that needle move back again. But the first thing we have to do is get students with the high aptitude and the math skills and the interest in doing things into this training programs because they exist. And then we can figure out the skills mismatch and be able to train people. So MECs and other national associations are starting that again. And again, it was another recommendation out of the Advisory Policy Board of we need to continue campaigns into certain industries to make sure we get the best and the brightest to start thinking of those careers.
Well, I'm glad to hear the last two comments because that exposed to two other questions.
Okay.
I was going to ask one about the military and don't serve that, and I was going to ask a little bit about the manufactured image.
Definitely not. Look, our view is and our observation is that AI and digital transformation of other kinds is really going to do more about changing tasks within jobs than it is about destroying jobs or creating new jobs. It's going to do both those other things. Some jobs are going to go away. We're creating a whole lot of new jobs. But really the big change is that existing jobs, the tasks and the way they're done over time are going to change. And our research says that probably in the top 12 economies around the world, there's going to be about 120 million workers who are going to need retraining over the next 3 to 4 years, retraining of some kind to do their jobs differently. So that kind of throws us back to the question of what are we doing about reskilling within our companies. You know, we have a digital learning platform which gives like a Netflix interface with a bespoke set of recommendations for each and every employee. But we've got to be investing in that. We've got to be looking at job-to-job transitions. How do we get people from one job that might be threatened by digital transformation into another job without falling into unemployment and having to worry about the social safety net or lack thereof? So not saying that there aren't things to do, but we see them as eminently doable with the right investments. And you know, I think that the Workforce Policy Advisory Board was mentioned a couple of times. My CEO, Ginny Rometty, is on that board. One of the things that she's really keen on is changing some of the federal grants for higher education. For example, Pell Grants. You've got to do 600 hours of education, I think, to get a Pell Grant. But a lot more training and retraining for these jobs of the future and to deal with technology change is all about short-term training, much shorter than 600 hours. So she's pursuing an idea of something called Workforce Pell, which provides for training around about for courses of say 200, 250 hours instead of 600. So there's lots to do and there's lots we can do. And we shouldn't be looking at this fearfully, but really as an opportunity.
And I would just say I think it's great what she's doing. There are legislative proposals in Congress right now, the Jobs Act, and Senator Lamar Alexander just proposed short-term Pell Grants, again, for this type of thing. But the other thing I would say within the workforce development system at the state and local level, localities, the local workforce development boards, can spend up to 20% of their money that is for adults and dislocated workers on incumbent worker training in companies. Mm-hmm. That was a first when it was passed, but really to address the changing skill needs in companies. And I mean, it tends to be more for frontline and up, you know, toward the middle, but workers. But there are business service people from the one-stop career centers who can work with companies to do this. The issue then becomes to evaluate these investments, and in terms of, do they make a difference in terms of company productivity, in terms of the wages and promotions for the individuals who get this extra training? But there is incumbent worker money available.
Okay, let's see if there's anybody in the audience has anything they want to raise.
Meredith Broadbent, I just left the International Trade Commission. Could you comment on Kati's comment that training has gone down in terms of what U.S. companies are delivering in the last 10 or 12 years?
You know, IBM's spend on training has remained relatively flat. It's, you know, $500 million a year, but we're actually doing more training, because we're doing more online training, and more people are doing more training that's more relevant, because it's AI-driven now, and it makes recommendations which adapt with business strategy and which are targeted to the individual employee, as I mentioned. So it may well be that spend on training could be declining, and we're doing more and better training at the same time. I don't know the answer to that. All I know is that in our company and many other large companies, there is a huge focus on this, not only in what we do internally, but the partnerships we create with universities and colleges, mm-hmm. And to do things jointly and with government agencies of various kinds. So, you know, I'd look at those figures very carefully and try and peel them back a little.
That's good.
I wanted to ask. My name is Layla Christie. I wanted to ask about something that was talked about and emphasized heavily on the presentation, which was how some job applicants get discouraged from applying just because of the amount of questions and qualifications. But with the amount of people that with the increase of people that are underemployed and not satisfied with their jobs, would that actually continue to be a problem to have that many questions if they want to know more about the job they're getting into and make sure they get enough hours, enough benefits, and everything?
Yeah, Matt, you know, what we saw in a number of surveys that have been done out there, and this is actually one of the problems, is that papers like ours have to be coupled together from different disparate sources, just because there isn't a lot of data that we could blow up the survey data into a bigger data set. That would be probably very useful. I saw in a number of studies and surveys that there is this that hard abandonment, if you will, by applicants that enter the job search process and then subsequently give up just because of the application is so complex, the skills required for the job are so high or diverse, and also because it's just such a long application that it takes you a long time to fill it. There are probably people who are actively looking for work, and they may have more patience for that, but at the same time, those people are probably wanting to apply to a number of jobs. And then there are a lot of people who are either working part-time or working full-time, and they have only so much bandwidth to then look around for work. So I came away with looking at those articles and number of studies that have been done as, you know, feeling that there's actually quite a lot that can be streamlined and simplified in the at the top of the funnel when the applicant looks at this process, and perhaps to accommodate the way in which, you know, you as a younger generation, millennials, are looking for work, how you apply for work through mobile phones, looking for job opportunities on social media and so on. And there's a whole cultural shift that probably has to take place. Whether employers are now, you know, it seems from some empirical studies that
employers are now relaxing some of the skills requirements that, you know, increased quite a lot during the recession when the pool was greater. But perhaps we'll see some adjustments as these data keep coming out and employers are concerned that the right people are not coming to the funnel or they give up once they are in there. So I would imagine that there are some, you know, fine-tunings as companies learn about the findings, such as that I discovered during the process.
I would add that one of the things that paper addresses, that we don't spend quite as much time on here, but it's slightly different population, is people that are already working that are looking for other jobs. And thinking about the perfect match, that's relevant population who are either unsatisfied with their current job or maybe satisfied with wondering something better out there. And they in particular are going to have less patience for very long time. But they're already working. They have routines that are busy. And they're not particularly interested in filling out the plan for very long. But so we have time for one more if there is one. Yes, in front. Those who you are.
Sure. Hi, I'm Roberto Yamas. I'm with Enterprise Solutions. We're a technology company here in the area. And my question is, I understand all the technology, all the challenges from a global scale, localized scale. But my question would be in the terms of a triple helix collaboration, public, private, academic collaborating, within a community. Earlier you said it's highly localized, and of course there's some mobility, you know, and then I also heard about technology applications being black box or, you know, being very particular. So what's your take in terms of, you know, adopting a triple helix platform that will foster collaboration between these three sectors within a community, addressing talent issues that hopefully leads to the fourth strand of the DNA, which is a quad helix, which is the, you know, the job seekers.
I can give a little bit of that. I think, and we talked around it and about it a little bit, that the technology is good if it has the right information in it. So many companies, especially in the small mid-sized manufacturing firms, they need to work with their local communities, the education system, the workforce system, to get better at coming up with clearer definitions of what the skills and competencies are. Most companies regurgitate an old job description that says, I want a skilled machinist that has 15 years of experience working on this piece of equipment. That's the purpose world in this manufacturing company. They're not going to find it. And I have told them, okay, if somebody with that level of experience is on the street, you may not want them. I mean, there might be a reason, okay? So in today's unemployment system, so you're going to have to think differently about, number one, there's 15 other pieces of equipment that are so similar to that piece that if somebody had even a year of that experience on another piece of equipment, you could train them. So how do you define that differently? And if you can define it in terms of competencies and skill requirements, the job description, and then the individuals can start defining their self in terms of skills and competencies, now your technology can start doing the matching easier. And you probably need to start locally because companies need to sit down and talk with each other about what does that mean. So if you're using similar terminology, it's going to make it easier for the job seeker and workforce system be able to play in that field.
Mm-hmm. I would just add to that a couple of things. Every local area has, within a state, there are local areas that have what are called workforce development boards. They are business chaired, and they have a majority business members. But on those boards are also educators. They're at various levels of education. And nonprofit organizations and others. So one suggestion is, if you're looking for that, go join a local board. They're appointed by chief of local and elected officials. And they put together plans that blend economic strategy and labor market skills and needs, the supply and the demand side. And they look at their growth industries and occupations. They look at what skills are needed. So I think that's important. The other piece that I would just add is, in addition to articulating the skills for the certifications, it's important for employers to start hiring by the skills and not by the resume or the application process. So I think those are